Let's begin now with CNN senior international correspondent Matthew Chance. He is live on the ground for us in Kiev. And Matthew, CNN is learning that American officials actually believe the capital could fall to Russia here within days. What can you tell us?
Well, that time frame seems realistic. In fact, it could be sooner than that because, you know, as we speak, I can hear the rumblings of artillery fire or explosions taking place a short distance from here, just to the north of the city, where we know from our reporting that there are forces of Russia located on the outskirts of the city. They've entered the city near a location called Obolon, which is a suburb outside of the center of Ukraine. Also, we did that reporting yesterday showing Russian special forces that had taken hold for that moment of a strategic air base in that same kind of direction as well. You know, as that fighting takes place, there has been an appeal from the Ukrainian president, Vladimir Zelensky. He's made one of his social media statements, and he said this: there's a fight going on, not just in Kiev, but in the whole of the territory of Ukraine. And he made this direct appeal to the Russian leadership, to Vladimir Putin. He said, let's sit down at the table of negotiation so that we can stop people from dying. So that appeal from Vladimir Zelensky, an 11th hour appeal, if you like, to come to the negotiating table for Vladimir Putin, for the sake of people's lives, so that more are not killed in this, you know, full-scale invasion that Russia is waging against this country. Earlier today as well, within the last few hours, I got the opportunity to question the Russian Foreign Minister, Sergey Lavrov. Of course, he was talking to me as we were hearing the shelling on the outskirts of the city. Take a listen to what I asked him and what he had to say about the situation. I'm in Kiev right now, and it is under attack, Mr. Lavrov, from Russian forces. And I'd like to know what your plan is for the leadership of this country. Do you intend to decapitate the leadership of this country? Why are the Russian forces now entering Kiev, surrounding the capital and battling with Ukrainian military? Do you intend to decapitate the Ukrainian leadership? Could you give me a simple answer, please, sir?
Nobody is going to attack the people of Ukraine. Nobody is going to somehow degrade the Ukrainian armed forces. We are talking about preventing neo-Nazi and those promoting genocide from ruling this country, because the current regime in Kiev is under two external control mechanisms, first the West and the US, and second, neo-Nazi, those who are imposing their culture, and it is flourishing in Ukraine today. As for your feelings as someone who is in Kiev at this very moment, I will stress, read what Putin said. No strikes on civilian infrastructure. There are no strikes on the personnel of the Ukrainian army in their dormitories or other places not connected to the military facilities.
Right, well, no strikes on civilian infrastructure or on the military, given the situation we're witnessing, though. I don't know how reassured we can be from the remarks of the Russian foreign minister. I can tell you that Vladimir Zelensky, the Ukrainian president, is deeply concerned about his own security. He made a statement yesterday on social media saying that he believes the enemy, by which he means Russia, of course, has made him the number one target in the country, and they've made his family the number two target. And so he is taking precautions, as are other senior Ukrainian officials, in the event that the next step of Russian forces is not just to surround the capital city of Ukraine, but to come in and, you know, as I mentioned there, to topple the leadership and replace it with a pro-Moscow regime, which is the big concern here, John.
Look, yeah. Matthew, just to give people a sense of where you are, you're in the city center right now, which is right here. And then, you know, yesterday, this is where you were up here at the airport. This is where the fighting appears to be going on right now in the Obolon district right now. Brianna, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Oh, no, I was just going to say that was a lie, just to be very clear. It was lie after lie that we heard from Lavrov there, and it's just verifiable. You know, we have Matthew on the ground. We have all of our correspondents on the ground. You point out where he is, Berman. We have reporters all across the country who are able to tell us that what Lavrov there is saying is just completely incorrect. That was all I was going to add to that. And Matthew, also I want to ask you, we've been hearing that officials are asking people to arm themselves with Molotov cocktails, weapons. A stunning number of weapons have gone out to civilians. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, the Ukrainian officials are calling on the citizenry of the country to pick up weapons and defend the city of Kiev, for instance, from attack from other cities as well, encouraging them to use petrol bombs, Molotov cocktails. There have been 18,000 weapons, according to defense officials, distributed to the civilian population to help in that defense against what is a concerted Russian advance. I mean, the problem is it's not clear how effective that kind of resistance in these early stages of a concerted Russian invasion is going to be. It may well stall a Russian advance. But the danger of that, of course, is that if the Russians feel that they have sent in an underpowered force to achieve their strategic aims, whatever they are, the risk is that they could redouble that force and send in an even more powerful, even more brutal invasion, army of invasion, to make sure that they're victorious. And I think that's, judging by the remarks we've heard coming out of the Kremlin, from Vladimir Putin specifically, but also from his officials like Sergey Lavrov, you get the sense they are not in the mood for negotiation. For instance, that call by President Zelensky here in Ukraine for negotiations with President Putin, with the Russians, to save people's lives has gone completely unanswered. Brianna, John.
All right, Matthew Chance in Kyiv, thank you very much for being with us. We're going to go to Frederick Plykin right now, who I do understand is over the border in Russia. Fred, why don't you tell me where you are?
Yeah, I'm in Belgorod. I'm almost the same place that you saw me yesterday. And one of the things that's really changed so far is, you might see, it's actually started snowing. The weather has seriously deteriorated. So that actually could be something that could make it more difficult for those Russian forces to launch some of their attacks that we saw them launch yesterday when we were speaking. We saw the Russian forces go across the border. However, guys, what I'm hearing here in Belgorod, which is really one of the biggest places where the Russians have forces along the border with Ukraine, is there is still a lot of missiles that are being launched. I've also heard planes overhead this morning. And, I was out here at the last sort of checkpoint before you get to Ukrainian territory throughout the night last night. And we, until well into the night, saw convoy after convoy of Russian forces move into Ukrainian territory. It happened until, I think we were there until about 3 a.m. In the morning, that you could see some armored convoys, some also just with people carriers, move towards the territory of Ukraine. The other thing that I also saw on the ground there, by the way, is by chance, we actually encountered some Russian special forces who were setting up shop there. So certainly they are also in the mix down there, and they would also, of course, be some of the first forces that would be sent in any sort of, if this invasion were to move even further into Ukrainian territory. So it really is going on in full force. You can feel that here in this town. You can feel that all around. One of the other things is also that our own movements are a little bit more restricted than they have been over the past couple of days. We have been held up at almost every checkpoint for an extended period of time just trying to move around here. You can feel how the Russians are maybe not getting more nervous, but certainly a lot more serious about security concerns. But also this offensive, I can tell you, is showing absolutely no signs of slowing down, guys.